Good morning, everyone. Happy Independence Day weekend. Welcome to our services. We're glad you came today. We're glad you chose to worship with us. And we want to welcome you, especially so if you're a visitor. We want you to feel welcome today. Hopefully, if you're a visitor, if you're a first-time visitor, you got a visitor's card. If you didn't get one from our welcome team, there are some in the back of the pews if you want to fill one of those out so we have a record of your visit. And a pastor always reminds us when he announces this that we're not going to beat you to death with knocks on your door and emails and phone calls. We simply want to have a record of your visit. So if there's ever an opportunity that you would invite us to follow up with you, we have all that information. So please, if you're a visitor, please fill out a visitor card. We would appreciate that. All right, we're going to open our service with some scripture this morning. So I invite you to open your ears to the Lord and listen to a message from His Word before we begin our psalms.
Psalms 33, 2 through 9. Praise the Lord with the harp. Make melody to Him with an instrument of 10 strings. Sing to Him a new song. Play skillfully with a shout of joy. For the word of the Lord is right, and all His work is done in truth. He loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of the goodness of the Lord. By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, and all the host of them by the breath of His mouth. He gathers the waters of the sea together as a heap. He lays up the deep in storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of Him. For He spoke, and it was done. He commanded, and it stood fast.
Amen. Let's all be standing as we pray. All right, let's bow our heads together for prayer. Father, we thank You for Your goodness and Your mercy. We thank You for Your word, Lord, that encourages our hearts, challenges our minds. Father, we praise You for Your greatness and Your power and Your majesty. As we come today, Lord, we thank You for this country in which we live. It's the greatest place to live on the face of the earth. Oh, Lord, we have our problems, but they're not bigger than You. We thank You, Father. And we pray that You would bless everyone who's come today because we want to worship You in spirit and in truth. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us today, Father. Forgive us. Forgive us, Lord, for we've sinned. And we pray You would help cleanse our minds, wash our minds in the water of Your word from all the pollution, Lord, that this culture pushes upon us, that we might just turn our minds from all of that stuff, Lord, and turn toward You for a few minutes and worship You. We pray You bless everything that's done here today, that it may honor You. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I was doing the service outline late last night and picking out songs, and the Lord reminded me that this is Independence Day weekend. So I thought it would be good if we were to turn our minds for just a few minutes toward the blessing that God has given us of the greatest country on the face of the earth in which to live. Yes, it has problems. It has always had problems. But thank God, He's bigger than all those problems. Amen? Amen. So let's take a few minutes and just praise Him and thank Him and think about the gift that we have been given from Him and for those who've, over the years, who've shed blood and fought and given their lives and given their service to this country. So let's just all lift our voices and sing together. And yes, we're doing it a cappella. So you are the Greater Red Dam Community Choir today. So we're going to sing America the Beautiful. You ready? Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain,
For purple mountain majesties above the fruited plain, America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Oh, beautiful, for heroes proved in liberating strife, who more than self their country loved, and mercy more than life. America, America, may God thy gold refine, till all success, ignobleness, and every gain divine. Oh, beautiful, for patriot dream that sees beyond the years, thine alabaster cities gleam, undimmed by human tears. America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea.
Amen. Good job. I don't know how many of you have been around here this week for our vacation Bible school, but there was more excitement here going on this week and more energy in this room. Amen. Yes. So Pastor Calvin Smith, our pastor of children and youth, is going to come and thank the folks who worked.
Yeah, I just wanted to say thank y'all to everyone who volunteered, everyone who brought their kids out and allowed us to be with them this week. We had a very wonderful week. We averaged, I think, about 160 kids a night. So it was pretty full in here. It was a lot of fun, a lot of energy. And I just wanted to thank everyone who participated, helped out in decorating, cooking, games, everything. It takes a lot of people to put this together, and I just wanted to thank y'all for that. And we ended up raising about $3,900 for our local mission project.
So, man,
it's very exciting. So thank y'all very much.
These are selected verses from Psalm 34. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. The angel of the Lord encamps all around those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their cry.
Amen. His ears are open to their cry. I'm thankful that we have a God who can listen to us. Amen. This next song we're going to sing is entitled, Oh Glorious Day. This song is one that just gives you the message of the gospel. If you listen to the words and pay attention while you sing, you'll get the gospel in this song. So let's all stand again together. We're going to sing Glorious Day.
Praises. One day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The Word became flesh, the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living, he loved me, dying, he saved me, buried, he carried me, my sins far away.
Please remain standing.
Bow your heads. Let's go to the Lord in prayer.
Father, what a privilege to be in your house with your people this Lord's Day as we exalt the name of your Son, Jesus. Lord, it's our prayer, it's our heart's desire that your Spirit would just move in such a powerful way, Lord. The Scripture teaches that you inhabit the praise of your people. And so, Lord, we desire you. We desire your presence. We desire the movement of your Holy Spirit. And, Lord, we just pray that the Holy Spirit would move in such a way that he would just illuminate the truth in our hearts and lives to bring transformation for what we're going to hear today through your word. And so, God, have your way as we worship you, and we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated. If you want to go ahead and pull your Bibles out, if you have them, we're going to be in Matthew 4:19. We're kicking off a new series of messages that are probably going to last for about 3 weeks, and it's all going to be centered on this one verse. Matter of fact, this verse really is a verse that defines us not only as a church, but hopefully as individuals as well. And we're talking this morning and for the next few weeks about living with purpose, living with purpose. And so I just want to start off our time by asking you two questions, and you don't have to answer out loud, but I want you to just think about them just for a few moments. First question is this: what is the purpose of this church? Why do we exist? And really not just church, but all churches. What is the purpose? What is the rhyme and reason for why we are doing what we are doing? And then I want you to drill down just a little bit more, and I want you to ask yourself, what is the purpose of your life? Why is it that you exist? What is it that God has called you to? And do you know what your purpose is? You see, you and I are living in a day and age to where not only are we living in the last of the last days, but we are living in a time where there is just so much just confusion and apathy and downright depression and fear that has swept over the people of this nation. And to be honest, by and large, the average person has no reason or purpose or rhyme or reason why they do what they do. And I think more than ever, the church has to have clarity of why we do what we do. And I think as believers who are the church, we have to have clarity of why we do what we do. And so I think, and I believe wholeheartedly, that Matthew 4:19, as along with a lot of other verses, really gives that clarity of what the church's purpose is. And in that, you will find what your purpose is as a follower of Jesus Christ. And this morning, I want to take the time to walk through this with you. And it's my prayer, it's my hope, that it is going to spark a zeal and a passion for you to live life again. We are living, as I said, in a time where there will it's a psyop, is really what's taking place. There will never be another time in our lives that something will not happen, that all the things around us will not cause us to question what happened, whether it was reality or not. I mean, in the shifts that has happened in heaven, in the heavenlies, and the demonic oppression that has taken place is absolutely unreal. And we are living in a day and age where we literally are questioning everything that takes place. And in that, it's caused us to develop this inward focus. And when you have an inward focus, depression, you just quit living. All of those things just overwhelm us. And I hope that this series of messages is going to help us develop an outward focus and really give us some real clarity of why we do what we do, and in that, to create some real passion and zeal about life. Because I'll remind you that Jesus said it, and he said it very clear. He said, I come to give life, and to give it what? More abundantly. And out of all the people that live, no matter what may be going on around us, the believer should be the one that has the joy of the Lord that is resting on their lives. And so how do we do that? I think you have to have clarity of why you exist and what your purpose is and what the purpose of this church is, what the purpose of your life is all about. And so with saying all of that, hopefully you found your place, Matthew 4:19, and let's look at this together. Now, context, and you can read in verse 18, Jesus is walking on the Sea of Galilee. He sees two brothers. He sees more than that, but these two brothers, specifically for verse 19, Andrew and Peter, and he issues this call to them. And he says, that's Jesus, he says to them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. I think this very verse sums up not only what the purpose of the church is, but if Jesus is your Lord and Savior, then it will sum up what your purpose of life is all about and is about since you've trusted Christ as your Savior. And we're going to spend some time fleshing this out of what this looks like and what this means. But Jesus issued the call Specifically in this text, Andrew, Peter, he says, follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. And there's three things that we're going to talk about over the next 3 weeks that are taking place in this verse that are specifically should be taking place in your life. For starters, and what we're going to hone in for the vast majority of our time this morning is the follow me. So in that, he is issuing a call for them to commit their lives to him, to go on a journey with him, to follow him, to trust in him. And in that, there's going to be some transformation that's going to take place. Notice that I will make you. He's speaking of the transformational process, the work of what the Holy Spirit does in a person's life. And the transformation, there's three persons that are involved in that. It's ultimately the Holy Spirit. It's the person following. And it's also the persons or the people, the church that is coming alongside and that are investing and pouring into the life of that one who's following Jesus. And in Peter and Andrew's case, he says, follow me, I'm going to invest in you. There's going to be some radical transformation that's going to take place in you, and there's certainly going to be some radical transformation when the Holy Spirit comes upon you on the day of Pentecost. It's all not packed up in that verse, but Jesus knew what he was talking about because they were going to be in house with the Holy Spirit. He says, I will make you, I will bring transformation in your life, but ultimately you will be fishers of men. In essence, you will be about making disciples. So I asked you just a few minutes ago, what is the purpose of the church? Some of you may have said in your mind, well, the purpose of the church is for us to come together and worship God. Okay, I agree with that. We're to worship God. Some of you said, well, the purpose of the church is to evangelize and go to tell the lost about Jesus. Completely agree. The church is to be about evangelism. Folks say, well, the church is about training people and equipping people and discipling people. And I say, absolutely, that is what the church is about. And your definition or how you expand that may go in a lot of different directions, but it typically comes down to the point, loving Jesus, worshiping Jesus, investing in others, sharing life together in a community, and so much, and so forth. But in all of that, it can ultimately summed up is that what the church's purpose is following Jesus, being transformed by Jesus, and making disciples for Jesus. That is the purpose, because when we do that, guess what we're doing? We're loving God. We're loving people. When we are investing in people and we are intentionally trying to help people not only come to know Jesus but grow in Jesus, we're making disciples. We are being obedient followers. The purpose of the church is to be disciple makers. And in that, we worship and we love and we share life together as a community. Jesus says, follow me, I will make you fishers of men. If you and I make up the body of Christ, and that is our mission, that is our purpose, that is our mandate, collectively, then we certainly have to come to the place where we realize that that is our mission, our mandate, our purpose as individuals. Your purpose in life, if Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior, is to make disciples. Period. It is to go after people and invest in people. It is to pour your life out in people to be on mission with Christ. That is what we are called to do. And I want to make this very clear that when we do that, there is a shift from this inward focus to outward focus, and when we have an outward focus, then all of a sudden we begin to live. And what's happened to us in our culture here and within the last 3 to 4 years especially is that we've been jolted in so many different areas, and we've seen the demonic influence in so many different areas that we've just kind of pulled back and we've just allowed fear and this inward focus to overwhelm us. And I'm going to tell you that you are not living when that is your focus. Nero was on the throne when these guys launched out in ministry as far as when they were in the prime of their ministry. As a matter of fact, he ended up taking Peter and Paul's life and causing much harm to the body of Christ. But they were as bold as lions. Why? Because they knew their purpose and they were on mission with God and they had life and they had vitality. Why? Because they had an outward focus. And that was that they realized that they were called to follow Jesus, and in following Jesus, their lives are being radically transformed, and because of that, they're becoming fishers of men. Now, what I find interesting is Jesus never says, follow me, and I will make you professional Bible study goers. Listen, there's nobody in here that loves studying the Word of God more than me. But if all we do is study the Scriptures, and we never live them out, or our faith never develops feet to where we are investing in other people, then what in the world are we doing? We've made this clear. I've made this clear. I will say it again. We're celebrating the 4th of July, just 2 days from today. If you are hoping that the transformation of this nation is going to come through any political figure or political party, I just want you to know you're going to be disappointed. The only hope for anybody is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that is the mission and the mandate that God has given His people. What God has not called for is for us to have this great gulf between what we would call clergy, the professionals, and there are no professionals, by the way, and the congregants. When we stand before the cross, when we stand before the Lord, we are on level ground. The same blood of Jesus Christ, the same Christ that saves you and dwells in you, is the same Christ who saves me and dwells in me. And He has called all of us to go and to make disciples, to be fishers of men. There's no excuse, there's no reason of why we're not. And you may say, but you don't understand, Pastor, I just can't do it. I cannot articulate the theological truths that you do, the way you do, the level that you do. I just can't do it. That's just an excuse. Because God's not asking you to. You just go tell your story. You just go share what you know. Right? There's plenty of times that I get in situations where I don't know what to say. And you know the answer, what you do, you just be really honest. I don't know. But we can go find out together. But you can tell your story. You can say, I was once lost, but now I'm found. I was once blind, but now I can see. This is what Jesus has done in me. So Jesus says, follow me. He says, I will make you fishers of men. And so in that, there's this commitment to go after people. And so if we're going to live life with a purpose as a church, laser-focused purpose, real clarity, we have to understand why we exist. And he said, we exist ultimately to glorify God. Absolutely. And if we're going to glorify God, then we have to do what He's called us to do. Not to live in little holy huddles and just hold down the fort till Jesus comes back. But to get on the offensive side and to engage the losses around us. And if we are like Paul and we believe what he says in Romans 1, that the gospel has the power to transform people's lives, then why in the world will we not open our mouths and share Jesus? What the world needs is Jesus. And what we're talking about more is more than just evangelism. We're not talking about just going to your coworker and ramming Jesus down their throat. No, we're talking about you walking with Jesus in such a way that He's radically changing your life, that Jesus is showing up in the workplace, and you're not only sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ, but you are willing to come alongside and invest and in work and walk with that individual, even in messy relationships, and stay committed to it because you desire for the gospel to go forth. Discipleship is not a fast process. In many cases, it's a lifelong journey. But nevertheless, you are on mission and you are investing in people. So let's ask this question. If the purpose is to be a disciple maker, who is it that you're discipling? Who is that person that you're going after? And I think it starts in centric circles to where naturally it begins with our own children, especially if they're in our home. And that should never stop, but it shouldn't just be just our home. It should expand. And what I find very interesting is that when you get serious about your following of Christ, of your following Jesus, and the transformation that takes place in your life, God just begins to plant people and persons in your path for you to be able to speak into their lives and to invest in. So what does it mean to follow Jesus? Jesus says, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. So the issue for following is a commitment. It's a commitment to follow. It means a commitment to recognize and accept who Jesus is. Not only Savior, but Lord. He's the leader. He's the master of our lives. So when you got saved, there's this great exchange that took place. Is your sin and your wicked life for Christ and His righteous life? There was a great exchange that took place. God, the person of Jesus Christ, in the person of Jesus Christ, came to this earth. He lived, as you and I know, the life that we could not live. And then He goes to the cross, as you've heard me say, you literally hear me say every week, and He goes to the cross and He dies for our sin and our stead and our place. He's placed in the tomb on the third day. He's raised from the dead, as Romans 1:4 tells us, that literally it signified God accepted His sacrifice on our behalf because He was raised from the dead. And so when you get to that place of just recognizing and realizing that you're a wretched sinner and that you can't do life apart from God, and you come to that place to where you're ready to receive Christ, you're ready to give your life to Him, it's not just, hey, I'm going to get some hellfire insurance, and so I'm going to have hellfire insurance and be comfortable and kind of do my own thing. No, what it is that you recognize that, and there's a commitment in that of where you're saying, Lord Jesus, Your life for mine. Save me. In your hopelessness and in your brokenness, Lord Jesus, save me. And your sin is applied to His account. His righteousness is applied to your account. And you become the righteousness of God because of the beloved. And we're going to look at some verses here in a few moments where Jesus is going to talk about counting the cost and taking up one's cross. And I want to just say this very clearly. Nowhere am I teaching or preaching or is what Jesus talking about a work salvation. Paul makes that very clear in Ephesians 2, that salvation is a gift. It's a free gift from God. And so we are righteous before God and made right before God because of what Jesus did, everything that He's done on our behalf. So when we talk about following Jesus and making a commitment to Jesus and living on purpose with Jesus and making disciples, I don't do that hoping that God will accept me or approve me. I am already accepted and already approved, and so is anyone else who has received Christ as their Savior, not by what we do, but because of what Jesus has done for us. It's settled. It's done. But the other half of Ephesians 2, 8, 9, and 10, it says that we were created for good works. Wherever Jesus takes up residency, He brings new life. He brings transformation. And we're called to do good works. In following Him, there's a commitment of fleshing this out and being on mission with Him. And so there's a healthy tension between the fact that Jesus has paid it all, but yet He's called us to give it all. And you live between those tensions. Yes, we're settled. It's settled. We are the righteous of God because of the beloved. But because of what the beloved has done for us, we will strive and we will work to share and to tell and to make disciples for the kingdom because it is our act of worship to God. And so when Jesus says, follow me, what is happening is you are enlisting into His army, to His kingdom, to His lordship. And you're saying, you are not only my Savior, but you are my Lord. And I am abandoning self to you. You want it all. Where you lead, I will follow. Where you go, I go. And then what happens with that for the believer, we've lost all rights to ourselves. Meaning when we make decisions, we have to process those through the Scriptures in a biblical way to see how and what the Word of God says and what God says. Why? Because He's Lord of our lives. For so many of us, we've just adopted this mindset to where, just save me from hell and leave me alone and let me do my own thing. That is far into the New Testament. That when you place your faith and you receive, there's this commitment of following, and in that, this the lordship of His life over ours, and there's a following Him. So when He says, follow me, He says, in that, I'm going to make you fishers of men. Listen to what He says in John 12, in verses 25 and 26. He says, he who loves his life will lose it, and he who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Verse 26 says, if anyone serves me, let him follow me. And where I am, there my servant will be also. If anyone serves me, him my Father will honor. Notice the service, the dying to self, the loss of life, and how it's connected to following Jesus. So if you are a follower of Jesus, that means you have abandoned your right to rule and reign over your life, because there has been you've been bought with a high price. It's been the precious blood of Jesus Christ. He's your Savior. He's your Lord, meaning that He is Lord of your life. And so where He commands and where He goes, we must follow. He says, anyone that serves me, let him follow me. You say, I love Jesus. Then you have to do what Jesus has called you to do. And the purpose and mission and mandate that Jesus has given us is to make disciples. We come together collectively. We worship collectively. We exalt our voices together collectively. Why? Because of our love for Jesus. We strengthen, we edify one another, we serve one another, we do all of those things. But for what purpose, what reason? To glorify Him, because we want to stir one another up to go on and to go about being followers of Christ. And if we're followers of Christ, then what are we doing? We're investing our lives in other people. It's an outward focus. If you would flip over to John 14, these are just all passages where Jesus is preparing His disciples for His departure, and He's investing in them. But in John 14, 23, He says, Jesus answers and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. My Father will love him, and he will come to him and make our home with him. If anyone loves me, he will keep my word. You say, man, I love Jesus. I'm just not interested in following Jesus. Don't kid yourself. Your love isn't what you think it is. Now, once again, we're not having to prove ourselves to God because of what Jesus has done for us, but our love for God will lead us to the point of getting and being in uncomfortable places for the purpose of being on mission with Jesus. So when He says, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men, it's not this passive decision. It's an active, conscious choice of where you are making a conscious decision to belong to God, to be on mission with Him. Verse 24, he who does not love me does not keep my word. And the word which you hear is not mine, but it's the Father who sent me. See, Jesus loves the Father. And how does Jesus love the Father? Well, His love shows up by His actions and Him doing what the Father has placed upon His heart. His words are from the Father. Jesus going to the cross, it began in the Father's heart. He came to do the will of the Father. Matthew 16, 24. Through 26, it says, then Jesus said to His disciples, anyone who desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Man, this flies straight in the face of the attractional model church. You know, the consumer, seeker-sensitive model of the church is, let's just lay the red carpet out. Let's make everybody feel really good. Let's have all the bells and whistles. Let's be on cue with every single thing. Perfection is our value. And let's do whatever we can to make people comfortable to where they might get excited about saying yes to Jesus, but not really committed to following Him, not really committed with dealing with any sin in their lives, and certainly not committed to just seeing the Holy Spirit do radical transformation in their life. What a false witness of the church and of the body when we fall into this. And I'm telling you, you can pack people in. Just make it about themselves. But just know this, whatever it takes to get them, it's going to take that plus more to keep them. And I find it interesting that in Matthew 16, 24, what Jesus said, I mean, it's going to turn people away. It's not going to make people want to run to it. He says, if anyone wants to be His disciple, He says, then he's got to, desires to come after Him, He says he's got to learn to deny himself. That means to say no. When's the last time you said no to yourself and yes to God? So, but you just don't understand my heart. I do understand your heart and my heart. The scripture makes it very clear. It's deceitfully wicked. And that's why we constantly have got to put our hearts and our lives before the throne of God and say, God, examine our hearts in light of scripture. Help us to die to self that we may live to you. If anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross. What does it mean to take up his cross? A very vivid visual image that any first century believer or person would know exactly what Jesus is talking about. I mean, you think about a cross, you think about capital punishment, you think about execution, naturally death, but not just any ordinary death. It is a very painful, excruciating death. He says, if you want to come after me, he says, you better learn to take up your cross and die to yourself. And then notice he says, follow me. It's no passive decision. And it is a conscious decision to give up one's rights to their very life, to go on mission, to live a life of purpose with Jesus. What say you this morning? Does your life and your walk with Jesus look like that? Is your mindset of such a one that you are, quote unquote, a missionary because you are a follower of Jesus and that you want to live on mission with him? That you want to be or see God glorified in you by your obedience of pouring into other people's lives? You see, when you follow Jesus, naturally there's this personal relationship. There's a walk. There's a growth. There's this one-on-one time that you have with him. There's this vibrant, healthy relationship because you can't follow somebody you can't see. And when you study the scriptures and when you cry out and you walk with God and you meet with God daily, then all of a sudden you can begin to sense and understand the leading of the Holy Spirit and how he's leading and where he's moving. It's amazing to me that when I walk close with God, it's as if the scales are removed from my eyes and my heart is tender to the things of God, and I can see people that he's placed in my life, people's lives that need to be spoken into and so forth, and I could just see it. I could feel, I could see where God's leading 9 times out of 10. But man, when I am not where I need to be spiritually, and I will admit there have been seasons and times in my life, just as they have been in yours, to where I haven't been. And then it's amazing how the, spiritually speaking, how there's literally just our eyes just, we just can't see. We can't see what God's doing. We can't feel his presence because of just our disobedience, of not knowing him intimately at that moment and walking with him. Could you imagine what your life would be like if today you said, you know what, Jesus, I've known you as Savior, I've walked with you, but today I'm nailing the stake down. I'm making this conscious decision of where I want to passionately follow you and to live a life of being on mission with you. And I don't know what all that entails. I don't know what it all looks like, but I know this, that wherever you lead, I'm going to follow. That my life belongs to you. And there's nothing, and I mean absolutely nothing, that's in my life that's off limits to you. That's what gets most people. Jesus, I'm willing to follow you, but I'm not willing to let go of this. Or even maybe the thought of dealing with that. See, the follower of Jesus has lost all rights to themselves and said, Jesus, it's all yours. So you deal, you show. It's surrender. Following Jesus is surrendering your life to him, where he not only is saving you, but he's transforming you and your own mission with him. And back to 4:19, where he says, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. That is an active investment in others. And we're going to talk a lot more about what it means to be fishers of men or disciple makers. But I will tell you this for this morning. It means actively investing in other people and pouring your life out in other people. And you may be in here today and you may say, but yet you just don't understand, Kevin. You don't understand what I'm dealing with. You don't understand what I'm walking through. You don't understand the attacks that the enemy has brought on my life. You don't understand any of those things. And the answer is, I may not. But I do want to tell you this. You're not going to rest your way out of your depression. You're not going to outthink your way out of what you're dealing with. The way you're going to overcome it is that God's going to overcome it. And how does God overcome it? Is that God puts people in our path, typically, who are worse off than what we are, and you have to serve and minister and pour your life out in other people and serve your way out of it. Meaning that if we get serious about focusing on others as we are following Jesus, and in that he's going to lead us to others and pouring our lives out to others, it is absolutely amazing the health and the radical transformation that he makes in our lives when we begin to make life about drawing people to Christ and people growing in Christ than we do about our own problems and our own struggles. And sometimes you just have to serve your way, minister your way out of what you're in. And I want to tell you something, we're in a day and age to where if you sit back and you watch all the reels and you stay on social media, you stay on the news, for goodness sakes, all of that, and that's all you listen to, and that's all you feed your mind, I'm telling you right now, you will pull back, you will be overcome with depression, you will have fear all over your life, you will have, what is the rhyme, reason, or purpose of living, you will quit living, and you will be a defeated person. But if you will do what Jesus says, and follow the invitation of where he says, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men, then you will not only see your life radically changed, but you will see God use you to change other people's lives in a radical way. But you got to make that decision. He said, whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. What say you this morning? Are you willing to follow Jesus no matter what the cost is? Even if you're in a relationship and you know it's not what God wants for you? Are you willing to say, you know what, God, I'm willing to even put that relationship on the altar because you are Lord of it all? What do you ask for? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the challenge of Scripture. Jesus, help us to really flesh out and really think through what it means to be a follower of you. God, so many are just existing and not living with purpose, and now is the time for the church to live on mission with you. We need clarity, and it's here in the pages of Scripture. And so, Lord, help us to have clarity in our lives and in this church. God, help the call that you issued to Andrew and Peter to be the very thing that we wrestle with and that rests in our lives as we look to you. Father, for those that may be in here this morning that have never trusted Christ as their Savior, God, I pray that they understand the gospel, that you love them so much that you sent Jesus to die for them. And salvation is theirs. It's a free gift. And all they've got to do is be willing to receive. And in receiving, they become born again, brought into the family of God, and they enter this new life where they're called to follow and walk with you. Lord, I pray that if there's those in here this morning that are crying out in their hearts, Lord Jesus, save me, that they're willing to, that they're doing that, Lord, and we know that what Scripture says, all of heaven is rejoicing because of that. And I pray, God, that that they would share, that where we could celebrate as well. Father, we give you this invitation as we honor and glorify you. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
O Lamb of God, I come.